I'm very happy to note that the hall is full of positive vibes as luminaries from all walks of life have adorned this auditorium this evening. By expressing our heartfelt pranams to all the 9 founding fathers of this great bank, let us start the Founders Day celebration of this memorable day of 18th February 2020. Every year, 18th February is your day with Karnataka Bank. Today, the 18th of February 2020 marks the 96th birthday of our bank. That means we are just 4 years short of our centenary year, that is 2024. This is a saga of 96 years of growth, achievement, purposeful existence and active involvement in the process of nation building. This is a growth story of a socio-economic movement called Karnataka Bank. Karnataka Bank is unique because it is time-tested and professionally managed shareholders bank. Bank has an enviable track record of earning profit during all the 96 years of existence. Furthermore, bank has also rewarded its shareholders with the dividend in 94 out of 96 years. That is the track record of Karnataka Bank. At this juncture, I am also happy to inform a good news to all the shareholders that bank has now proposed to come out with the issue of bonus shares in the ratio of 1:10 very shortly. You all know that we are one of the early banks to embrace technology by introducing core banking solution during 1999-2000 itself, that is about 20 years back, when the entire banking sector was just thinking of introduction of the core banking solution, it was Karnataka Bank which took the early steps. Now also, we are one of the few banks to introduce a new technology in the banking sector called digital loan sanction. During last year, you all know that, that is the year 2018-19, we earned the highest ever profit of ₹477.24 crores. Our bank has exhibited consistency in the current financial year also by having more than 100 crore profits in each of the 3 quarters of the current financial year. In fact, our net profit for the first quarter was 175.42 crores. Second quarter, it was 105.91 crores, further improved to 123.14 crores during the Q3 of the current financial year. Our business turnover stood at a new high of 1,26,267 crores as of December 2019, and the customer base has crossed 11 million mark. That's a new high for Karnataka Bank. Bank has 845 branches across 22 states and 2 union territories. Karnataka Bank is regarded as one of the well-capitalized banks in the entire banking industry in India, as we have a capital adequacy ratio of 13.17% as of March 2019. Friends, you all know that the banking sector has been witnessing a paradigm shift since last 2 decades. First decade of the current century, that is the 21st century, saw the banks in India implementing core banking solution for the banking operations, enabling them to introduce the concept of anywhere banking and anytime banking. The second decade of the current century is dedicated to alternate delivery channels with various facilities like ATMs, internet banking, mobile banking, etc. for hassle-free customer experience powered by technology. Now we are entering into the third decade of this century. Digitalization has touched every walk of life, and banking can never be an exception for that. It is therefore visualized that The digital sanction of loans is the next game changer in the Indian banking sector. With this background, Karnataka Bank also felt that a transformational journey is inevitable to reposition the bank as a relevant and significant player in the banking industry and to eventually emerge as a bank of the future. Accordingly, our transformation project, KBL Vikas, was launched by the bank in November 2017 by having Mrs. Boston Consulting Group, BCG, a reputed global consultant as the transformation partner. This journey is centered around transformation of digital and IT, transformation of credit, and transformation of HR, etc. It was envisioned to be a holistic and inclusive transformation journey by recognizing our own members of staff as change agents. The transformation initiative, that is KBL Vikas, has now completed 2 years of journey, and we have successfully implemented various futuristic and forward-looking initiatives. Firstly, there is a paradigm shift in the sales and marketing culture in the bank. The culture of lead generation is institutionalized. About 300 plus dedicated sales officers, associates, regional sales executives, and CASA marketing officer CMOs are all onboarded. Sales activities such as more feet on street, kiosks, door-to-door campaign, we call it as D2D, have become an integral part of the daily routine of all our 846 branches across India. New business sourcing channels for loans such as DSA, BSA, MRA, etc. are introduced for augmenting the business. Secondly, a step change in in-house digital and IT capabilities is also ensured. By establishing our own Digital Center of Excellence, DCOE, at Bengaluru, on 16th January 2019, we have launched digital journeys for home loan, personal loan, auto loans, wherein in-principle sanction order is being given within 20 minutes besides providing SP tab banking facility. This is something new in the banking industry. This type of facility was available in the new generation banks. Karnataka Bank is one among the first banks to introduce this type of digital sanction of the loans. A CD&MO, Chief Digital and Marketing Officer, is also onboarded to drive the digital and marketing transformation initiatives. 100% digital process for mutual fund investments is introduced, and on top of it, we have opened a digi branch at Bengaluru, wherein prospective customers can just walk into that branch and open an SB accounts online and also print the debit cards, and entire this process, it would happen in just 10 to 15 minutes. You can open an account, you can also take a debit card printed from that machine. We have installed that type of thing, that's a digi branch at Bengaluru, and we have all plans to replicate this exercise across India in the days to come. Thirdly, transformation of customer experience and risk management. Regional loan processing centers have been established in all the 14 regions, which resulted in significant reduction of TAT, that is the turnaround time for loans sanction. Regional collection hubs, we call it as RCHs, were established to improve the health of advances portfolio. We have partnered with several fintech and digital service providers for DCOE and in other operational areas. Fourthly, HR transformation, the key for all these changes. A comprehensive and transparent PMS, performance management system, is introduced besides extending ESOP to all the staff members as a part of employee satisfaction and career development initiative. You all know that transformation is a journey which is regarded as a work in progress. Through transformation exercise, we have laid a strong foundation for a sustainable growth and development of the bank. We are now focusing on its sustainability, consolidation, and acceleration. my dear well-wishers of Karnataka Bank. I am also very happy to inform that bank has been very actively involved in meeting its social obligations through its corporate social responsibility initiatives in the areas of education, livelihood enhancement, empowering socially and economically disadvantaged, environmental sustainability, green initiatives, healthcare, Swachh Bharat, etc. You name any CSR activity, you will find Karnataka Bank there across India. Since last 4 years, I am very happy to share with you that we have supported 826 projects across India with bank's assistance amounting to 31.47 crores for under our CSR activities. As a mark of respect to our founders, today on this auspicious occasion, we have invited three beneficiaries under CSR program of the bank who will be given the sanction letters later in this program. We have started this tradition of conducting Founders Day celebration on 18th February of every year about 22 years back, that is during 1998, in a very systematic way to remember the founding fathers of the bank and also their yeoman service to the society. We bow our head to those great souls who had sown the seed of this great organization on this day in 1924. My respectful homage to the first 9 founding directors of the bank. They are Sri P.R. Vasarai Achar, Sri Nellikai Venkat Rao, Sri Pejavar Narayan Acharya, Sri Kalmadi Lakshmi Narayan Rao, Sri Pangal Subbarao, Sri Udupi Venkat Rao, Sri Sheshabhat Bide, Sri Narikombo Ramarao, and Sri Kakkunje Sadashiva Adiga. It is also my bounden duty to invoke the blessings of the doyen of the bank, late Sri K. Suryanarayan Adiga. It is he who tirelessly steered the bank for over 4 decades as chairman of this great bank. On this occasion, let us also salute with great respect and gratitude to all the past chairmen of the bank who have contributed their mite for all-round growth of Karnataka Bank. They are late Sri B.R. Vasarai Acharya. Swamiji, you can come front. Please come. Somebody can please escort. Our executives may have to be a little bit alert. Let us also remember great Sri B.R. Vasarai Acharya, late Sri K. Suryanarayan Adiga, late Sri K.N. Basri, late Sri P. Raghuram, Sri P. Raghuram, Sri P. Sundar Rao, late Sri H.M. Ram Rao, Sri U.V. Bhat, late Sri M.S. Krishna Bhat, and Sri Ananta Krishna, as well as our present chairman, Sri P.Jayarama Bhat, who also had the unique privilege of being the first MD and CEO of our bank. Every year, we have been inviting eminent personalities of national and international repute from different walks of life to deliver Founders Day lecture. This year also, we are very fortunate that a well-respected, internationally renowned banker, Srimati Arundhati Battacharya, the first ever woman chairman of State Bank of India, in its long history of 210 years, he is kind enough to accept our invitation to address us on this memorable occasion. In fact, when I met her in the IBA office about a month back at Mumbai last month, I was simply moved by her simplicity, professionalism, and her passion for banking. Today, she is going to talk on the subject, A Peep into the Future Banking. All of you would agree that the days would be more challenging, not only to your respective industry or the sector, more so for the banking sector. What type of challenges that we have, that we can envision, and how we can address those challenges, how the technology would come to our rescue. Definitely you will hear a great sharing of thoughts by none other than a very leading banker, Mrs. Arundhati Battacharya. I am sure you will all appreciate this timely subject, a very relevant subject as well. Mrs. Arundhati Battacharya is a retired Indian banker, and she has more than 40 years of rich and varied experience, coupled with thorough insights of banking industry and its related technology, which not only enabled her to put her imprint on the Indian financial space, but was also acknowledged and acclaimed globally. She transformed SBI to a tech-savvy bank, overhauled bank's risk structure, inculcating risk awareness at every level. She won many international accolades and recognitions in the past, which include figuring in the list of most powerful women by Forbes and Fortune. Number two, most powerful women in finance. Number three, world's top 100 thinkers. Number four, Fortune's greatest leaders, and being acknowledged internationally for her bank's employee satisfaction level. She has been recently bestowed with Lifetime Achievement Award by Financial Express Group in Best Bankers category. Presently, she is on the boards of prominent Indian companies with Reliance Industries, Piramal, Wipro and Crisil, and offers advisory services to select private equity firms, consultancy and law firms, as well as foreign banks. Government has nominated her to various select committees like Lokpal Search Committee, Padma Awardees Selection Committee, SEBI's Mutual Fund Advisory Committee, National Coal Index Committee, etc. She is also on the governing board of IIT Kharagpur and IIM Sambalpur. Mrs. Battacharya is a postgraduate in English and an associate member of Indian Institute of Bankers. I deem it a great privilege to have such an outstanding personality amidst us today. Please join me in extending a very warm welcome to Mrs. Battacharya. Today's function is presided by Sri P.Jayarama Bhat, Chairman of our bank. He has been a great source of inspiration and guiding force to all of us. I am happy to inform you that he has been recently elected unanimously as the Chairman of the Governing Council of Southern India Bankers Staff Training College, SIBTC, Bengaluru. I extend a warm welcome to our beloved Chairman, P.P. Jayarama Bhat, to this function. The bank has a galaxy of professional directors on the board who take utmost care to steer the bank on the path of growth and success with the highest standard of corporate governance. I recognize the august presence of following directors along with their family members, and I extend a warm welcome to each one of them. Sri Ashok Harnahalli, former Advocate General of Karnataka. Sri Ramandrao Belle, former CGM of SBI and the founding MD of SBI General Insurance. Sri U.R. Bhatt, a leading investment banker from Mumbai. Sri Keshav K. Desai, an industrialist from Hubli. Sri Dharmasthala Surendra Kumar, a leading educationalist. Madam Maithili Ramesh, an IT expert and former senior vice president of Wipro. And our additional director, Sri B.R. Ashok, a distinguished chartered accountant from Chennai. I heartily welcome our legal advisor, Sri M.E. Shankar Bhatt, and also our statutory auditors, Messrs. Manohar Chaudhary and Associates, represented by its partner, Sri Murali Mohan, and Messrs. Badri Madhusudan and Srinivasan, represented by its partner, Sri T.V. Sudarshan and Sri Rajendran, who are sitting here to this function. I also welcome Sri Ruchin Goyal and Sri Pratik Runta and their team representing BCG, our transformation partner. Ruthik? Yeah, they are sitting there. Yeah. Host of luminaries from Mangaluru, Mumbai and other parts of India, fellow bankers, elected representatives, officials of district and city administration, valued customers and well-wishers of our bank, from all over the country, and our past directors and shareholders are all with us today. My heartiest welcome to each one of them. I am also happy to recognize the august presence of Swami Viveka Chaitanya Ananda, President Ramakrishna Tapovan Palali, he is sitting there. And Captain Ganesh Karnik, ex-MLC from of Karnataka government. And Mr. Satish Marathe, RBI Director, he is sitting here. And T. Satish Upai and Madam Sandhya Pai, they are our special guests today. They are sitting here from Manipal Group. And Mr. Ashish Kumar Srivastav, Managing Director and CEO of PNB MetLife India. Ashish, please. And Mr. Tapan Singhal, MD Bajaj Alliance. He has also joined us. He has come all the way from Pune. And Mr. Ashish has come all the way from Delhi. And Mr. Vikas Seth, MD Bharati AXA. Vikas ji. Yeah, he is sitting here. And Mr. Vishweshwari Singh, Principal Officer, Universal Sompo General Insurance Company. And Sri Satish Chandra, President, Campco. And Sri Yenapoya Abdullah Kuinsab, and Yenapoya, yeah, he is sitting here from Yenapoya Group. And of course, Mr. Kalladka Prabhakar Bhat, he is sitting here. And I have Mr. K.C. Nayak also, Chairman of Shakti Education Group with us. And of course, Mr. M.B. Purani. If I look at the this audience, I should start telling right from the beginning. Let me not waste my time. Let us listen Madam Battacharya also. But nevertheless, I have recognized the presence of each one of you. Your name is very much imprinted in our heart, in the heart of Karnataka Bank. I also extend a warm welcome to all my executive colleagues and their family members, regional heads, all the past directors of the bank, presidents and general secretaries and the office bearers of All India Karnataka Bank Employees Association and Karnataka Bank Officers Organization, retired executives and all the serving as well as retired members of staff of Karnataka Bank. I recognize the august presence of Srimati Shubha Jayarama Bhat, Madam is sitting here, Annapurna Mahabaleshwar and Madam Uma Devi Krishna Bhat, she is here, and all other leading ladies of KBL family. I also recognize the gracious presence and extend a warm welcome to the representatives of various channel partners and business associates. I also welcome the members of print and electronic media, and my hearty welcome to Srimati Ushalata S., Assistant Station Director of All India Radio, Mangaluru, and her team who have arranged to air this program live. Warm welcome to Sri Leelakshabi Karkera. Karkera was sitting, yeah, he is sitting here. And his team of Namakudla TV channel who are beaming this program live. And bank is also streaming this great event live on its official pages of YouTube, Facebook and Twitter handle to reach maximum number of our well-wishers and valued customers across the globe. We are also having live streaming of this program to all our 845 branches, 14 regional offices and other offices across India for the benefit of all our 8,500 plus staff members who are witnessing this event live at their respective branches and offices. This program will be followed by Hindustani Carnatic Classical Jugalbandi by Padma Bhushan Pandit Vishwamohan Bhat on Mohan Veena, Vidwan Dr. Mysore Manjanath on violin, Padma Shri Pandit Vijay Ghate on tabla, and Vidwan Patri Satish Kumar on mridangam. I extend in advance a hearty welcome to all the artists as well. Once again, a warm welcome to all of you for this memorable Founders Day function of Karnataka Bank. Thank you.
Frankly, the kind of welcome I got over here was really overwhelming. In fact, you know, the amount of fish I have been fed, though extremely delicious, is enough to put me to sleep. The problem with the keynote address is it puts even the audience to sleep. So I will try my very best today to ensure that neither of us do that. I have been asked today to give you a peek into the future of banking. To say that I know for sure what is going to happen is really unwise. However, we can make some very informed guesses. The most important thing, though, is that banking, as well as many other disciplines, will soon become multidisciplinary, and the backbone on which all of this will run will be technology. Maybe we should think of future banking like an organic being, where the brain is technology, the spine 5G or whatever G it is, connectivity. But I'm sure that the heart will have its space, as human beings are social animals, and no equations can still perfectly replicate the human behavior. So today, if we are looking at the future of banking, basically we are talking about technology, we are talking about connectivity, we are talking about multidiscipline, we are talking about how the very many sciences and arts are all coming together to render an experience that none of us as yet can really imagine. In a manner of speaking, we are witness to a key moment in history, a moment which seems to portend a golden future. Technology seems to be holding out the promise of solutions to many insurmountable problems facing mankind. We know from history that human beings have always thrived when they have communicated and collaborated. This is now made possible by technology on an unprecedented scale. In fact, look at something like Facebook or Instagram or LinkedIn. How many of you here have found your long-lost school friends on Facebook? I have, and I'm sure if I ask for a show of hands, a lot of you will say that you have too. One other thing that you can find on Facebook are borrowers who are not paying, especially the student loan borrowers, who can't help but talk about the new jobs that they have got on their Facebook pages, but which they don't want to reveal to the banks. But it's a very great source of finding them. But this very platforms enables collaboration and cooperation to a degree that was unheard of before. So today, if you're looking for somebody to fill up a particular job, you go into LinkedIn, you'll find at least 20 suitable resumes, which in the earlier years, you never could have got. So technology, by bringing together mankind, by bringing together people, is actually providing us a huge number of solutions to problems that were insurmountable before. Consider, for instance, financial inclusion. You know, from the year 2010, SBI has been trying to do what is called financial inclusion. And I remember the first cards that were given out in the Northeast, because the Northeast was most affected at that point of time, happened sometime, I think, in before 2010. And it was an initiative that was taken with all earnestness. But it was not till 2014 that we really got into what is called financial inclusion. And that happened at the time of the PMJDY, the Prime Minister Jan Dhan Yojana. What was the reason that it actually became a success? One of the main reasons, of course, was connectivity, mobile connectivity. And the other reason was our ability to give an identity to the people on the basis of Aadhaar. So we could say that A is A and not B or C. That is the basic reason why financial inclusion happened at that point of time. That is the kind of advances that we are seeing in medications today. Medicine is again something where you are now beginning to actually imprint organs so that there will be no rejection of organs. That is the kind of stuff that is happening in the area of medicine. In the area of sustainability, look how the cost of solar panels have come down. We are now told that there are paints that if you put on a house, it will generate enough electricity for you to manage to run your equipments in the house during the daytime just from the paint, which acts like a solar panel. So whether it be the human condition on account of connectivity, whether it be areas of banking like financial inclusion, whether it be human health in the form of medication, whether it be greening the earth in sustainability, all of these things today are possible through technology. It is hardly therefore possible that banking can stay away from this and that banking will not become heavily dependent upon the progresses that technology makes. Sir, is loss of privacy. Loss of privacy is something that we all talk about. It's different, of course, that today's generation doesn't seem to consider privacy all that important. In fact, their most private moments are all there on social media for everybody to look at. That's a separate issue. But the fact remains that with loss of privacy, you also lose control of your lives. And therefore, to that extent, this is something again that people who are adopting technology need to be very aware of. And if you as a bank are considering having a lot of data on your people, how do you ensure that that data does not get into the wrong hands, that that data remains with the person to whom it belongs? So all of these are challenges that face us today. But in spite of this, the march of evolution will not cease. And those who fail to recognize it do so at their own peril. The thing that is different about the fourth industrial revolution, as it is called today, is the enormous speed of change. This speed is set to accelerate because today technologies are simply building on each other. It is the coupling of artificial intelligence with augmented reality and virtual reality, analytics, natural language processing, 5G, the Internet of Things, that is causing this rapid advance. Because current technology learns from experience. Today, if anything is discovered in the US, it takes only how many hours to reach China? Any idea? How many hours will it take for a new discovery to reach China? It takes 16 hours, and that too because of time zone differences. Because these people are sleeping when the US is awake, and vice versa. But it just takes 16 hours for it to travel to China. Growth, therefore, has become self-reinforcing. But besides that, what are the other challenges that the use of technology forces us to overcome? Take for example, artificial intelligence. Take for example, today, there is an application that looks at your medical data and then predicts whether you are a candidate for cardiac illness. Okay. There may be three or four such applications. Now, hospitals start using these applications. As they use it, one application seems to be giving better results. Now, the moment that application gives better results, more and more hospitals start adopting that application. And as this particular application gets more and more cases, its predictions become better and better and better. And now, what happens then is that the rest of the applications start getting lesser usages, lesser users, and therefore their predictive ability gets to be far worse. And as a result, ultimately what is happening is that you are creating something like a monopoly where the winner takes all. Further, we also must remember that technology is evolving very fast, and therefore destruction of certain applications can also be as swift as its build-up. As such, we also have to understand what is the return that we are going to get when we put our money behind many of these solutions. However, another problem that faces us is to realize when to put money behind a particular technology. When has the time come? I remember even when I was a small kid, I was told that robotics in Japan is very advanced. They have robo-pets, they have robo-caretakers, but it never seemed to go to the rest of the world. However, suddenly, there is today a proliferation of robotics. In fact, 3 years back when I visited my ranch in Nepal, I was greeted by a robo-greeter. And I was really surprised. This was a branch in Nepal, mind you. And just, I think, last week, I read about a robo-waitress in Afghanistan, of all the places. So suddenly you are seeing that the world is waking up to robotics. Now, is it therefore, in fact, we already have a robo-greeter in HDFC Bank, though I don't know how far they are successful with it, but they do have a robo-greeter. So if you are looking at technology, is it the right time to put your money in robotics? Take, for instance, something like quantum computing. Now, many of us don't even know what quantum computing is, but the word is being used everywhere. And we are told it will take about 10 years for quantum computing to come into mainstream application. When do you start investing in quantum computing? Take, for instance, another word which is there everywhere, every day, blockchain. Now, from blockchain, I have talked to many, many people. And the wisest person was the one who told me that blockchain is a solution waiting for a problem. So, you know, there are so many things that are out over there and we don't know which are the technologies that we should invest in. And will be then able to tell you whether you have a clean record and will be able to give you the loan. All right. But why is that something that is not being used today? One of the reasons is that there are several groups who are trying out blockchain. From last count, there were more than 39 serious groups trying out blockchain. But none of these groups talk to each other. They don't have a common language. It's like a Tower of Babel. Each one is doing stuff within themselves. Why? Because they all know that there is a big commercial opportunity, and if they cooperate with each other, they may lose out on that commercial opportunity. They are all hoping that they'll become the Amazon of blockchain, that they will capture the whole thing so that they get that commercial opportunity. But in the meanwhile, there are all kinds of small groups that are trying out all kinds of different experiments to determine whether this is something that will work. But the result is that all of this is in the prototype stage. Not a single one of these operations have gone mainline. But if you are a bank, and if you are seeing all around you, people are talking blockchain, are experimenting with blockchain, is this the right time for you to start doing that? We didn't have a presence in the social media. SBI had no digital strategy. And when I insisted that we go on the social media, the first thing that my MD said was that you're going to get trolled in social media. We were that confident about our customer service, okay? So we knew that we are going to get trolled there. So I said, fine, if we get trolled, so be it. We will then know what is wrong with us. So you have to be on social media. I must tell you, by the time I left the bank, we were number one on all social media. And in Facebook, we were number one in the world. Of course, mainly because China is not on Facebook. That's the reason. But still, we were number one there. Okay? Now, when it came to the digital strategy, When I said that we need a digital strategy, a number of my people came back and said, Madam, we don't understand what you're talking about. Because we already have the internet banking. We have mobile banking. What's digital? That's digital. That's not digital. And frankly, when we actually embarked on the journey, I was surprised to see that IBM, who was our partner, even they felt that was digital. They also needed to be explained that digital is something totally different. Every single process is different. And I will give you a very small example of what I had said then as to what should be digital. Many of you have accounts which have checkbooks, right? In fact, I think all of you have accounts which have checkbooks. Now, when there are just three or four leaves left in a checkbook, what do? You send in a requisition form. In a digital system, you would not have to send in any forms. The digital system would recognize how many checks you normally use per month. Okay? And depending upon, say, you use 5 checks a month. So therefore, when you have used up your 6th last check, it would automatically dispatch the next checkbook to you. That's digital. Similarly, all of you must be having PPF accounts, public provident fund accounts. All of you know that after the 4th year, you can withdraw 1/4 of your PPF savings. And you can invest that in something else if you want to. Now, how many of you actually go and do that withdrawal? The first reason is you forget about it. The second reason is it's one of the most difficult things for a bank to get it out of a bank. Because, and I'm talking about SBI because we were authorized to open PPF accounts right from the beginning. Because you had to calculate the interest of each year, then you have to work out 1/4 of that, then you have to make out the payment. All of that has to be done manually. Nobody's interested in doing it. And yet in a digital process, the moment a 1/4 became due to you, you could actually get a small SMS that would tell you that your PPF account balance is this. This is the amount that you can take if you wish to. If you wish to, click on this link and the amount will be in your account. That's digital. Because it was so difficult for people to really understand what was happening, we decided that we will create a few branches. So we created 7 flagship branches in 7 malls in India. Okay, we didn't go to to other places, we went to malls. Because malls have a lot of footfalls and I wanted not only my customers, but even my staff and their families to go visit these branches and see what it was all about. The entrance of the branch, and this was sometime in 2015, so it was quite early on, 2015-16. The entrance of the branches, of course, you know, had your ATM and your cash deposit machine, your check deposit machine, your multifunction kiosk, your passbook printer machine. Once you went inside, and this portion was open 24/7, but once you went inside, you had a lot of screens. And on the screens, you could play around. For instance, you could go touch on the screen and say, I want a car loan. And the screen would ask you, do you want a used car or a new car? And you can choose. And then it would ask you how much you want to spend. Given the amount you want to spend, it will show you all the models. Then if you click on a model, it will show you what social media is saying about that model, what the manufacturer is saying about that model. And then it will ask you, do you need a loan? And if you say yes, it will ask you a few basic questions about how much you earn and how much you spend. And then it will generate for you an EMI, and you can adjust the EMI depending upon how many years you want to pay it in or what is your ability to pay. And then it can even generate for you a pre-approval letter, because YONO was the outcome of this digital journey. We started in 2015. YONO is the application of State Bank of India, as you know, and it's a short form of you only need one. And YONO is supposed to be an application that allows you to do your banking as well as allows you to connect to any other site you want. So we have over 100 partners. And very recently, I was reading an article from the current chairman, Rajneesh of SBI, and he says that we now have 25 million people on YONO with 70,000 registrations per day. And the amount of personal loan portfolio that they have built up on YONO is something like 14,000 crores. Okay. Now, the cost of YONO that he has mentioned over there was 800 crores. But I am sure that is only up to now, and there will be further costs going ahead. We thought, we really said that we should have a look at a peak in the future as to what it should look like. So now let's try and envisage the life of a bank employee 5 years hence. And these scenarios that I am giving you are scenarios that have been discussed on public forums. Okay? So the person gets woken up by a digital assistant, Alexa plus plus. This is not Alexa, this is Alexa's current version. Okay? So Alexa, by the time it wakes up person A, let's call him A, or Amit, let's call him Amit. By the time Alexa wakes up Amit, his breakfast is already being prepared as per his diet plan. His tea water is already on, and he's woken up by Alexa, and he's told by Alexa that your Uber has been ordered depending upon the traffic that we expect during this day, and probably you are going to get a new boss, so you should probably dress in this manner because the boss that you are getting is very conservative, likes to see you dressed in a conservative manner. So it will tell you what you are to dress in, it will tell you how you are going to go to the office, it will even probably tell you what your boss's mood is like if your boss has been posting on social media. Okay? And then in due time, your Uber will arrive, and in all probability, if you're in a smart city, it will be a driverless Uber. So you will get into it, come to the office. During the journey, you will be briefed about the clients that you are meeting and what the client's problems will probably be given their record in the bank. You get into the bank, and then you can immediately get into an augmented reality or virtual reality training module and refresh the kind of things that you need to talk to the client about. Refresh your knowledge about that. Now you need to sit back and determine how close is your banking to this. And if it isn't, how do you get there? You know, very often I have been asked that, you know, what keeps you awake at night? Of course, this was when I was chairman. Nowadays, nobody asks me that. They know I sleep well. Okay? But when I was chairman, very often I was asked this. And most people expected I would say NPS. But really speaking, I'm telling you, NPS didn't keep me awake at night. Because I knew I was doing my level best for the NPS. There was nothing more I could do. That I would solve it or I may not solve it depending upon what the situation would be like. So that was not what used to keep me awake. What did keep me awake? What kept me awake were these questions. What happens to our workforce when 90% of the routine tasks get automated by artificial intelligence? That's a question that really used to keep me awake. My way of answering it was starting the wealth management initiative. Because I thought that there are two things where human beings want the touch of another human being. One is health and the other is money. The two things that is dearest to all of us, okay, over and above your loved ones, that will ensure that your assistant or your experience given by that assistant is better than that of your competing bank. So the fact is that you must never lose sight of the human angle. And if you don't lose sight of the human angle, by ensuring that you are responding to the human pieces of the interaction, you should be in a position to stay a step ahead. The third question that I used to have is, how do we create a collaborative ecosystem when we are also competitors? You look at YONO. YONO at the end of it all cannot only be a banking software. It is also a software where it should allow you to approach e-commerce platforms, to enable you to do your bookings, to enable you to buy tickets, to do all of that. Now the fact remains that if I am going to also create these people as partners, people who are also actually having things like wallets, where they want my customer to keep their money, how do we then collaborate and yet compete? How does one do that? It seems to be a conflict, but it can't be a conflict. We need to find a way. And the way to do that is you have to come up with win-win solutions. You have to come up with ways of sharing your customer and hoping that your customer experience remains that much superior, so that even while sharing, that person is not able to take away your customer. It's an everlasting battle. It's not something that will end in a day or two, but you have to keep working on it. And last but not least, how do we tackle the ethical issues surrounding these technological developments and ensure that trust remains paramount? Remember, banking is all about trust. Karnataka Bank, if it is celebrating 96 years, it is doing this because it has kept the trust of the people. How do you ensure that you do nothing which hampers the trust of the people, that you do not use their data in a manner that is detrimental to them, that you use their data with their express consent, that whatever you do is done in their interest and not in yours? In respect of the wealth management, for instance, I made it mandatory for them that they would not recommend something like an SBI mutual fund unless that happened to be in the top two quartiles. A more fair, equal and sustainable capitalism that actually works for everyone. We don't have to choose between doing well and doing good. They are not mutually exclusive. Values will create value. I think we need to remember this. Values will create value. So I'd like to end on this note with a prayer and a hope for a future that is exciting and empowering. A future that beckons with promise and hope, and which I am sure will come to pass. We can only guess at its contours, but as long as we remain true to our values, we can't go far wrong. Thank you.
Dr. Anand B. Halgiri, Director, Purna Prajna Institute of Scientific Research, Bengaluru, to collect bank's offer letter of financial assistance of rupees 25 lakhs towards the installation of solar roof, a top voltage system at their Bengaluru campus. The sprawling campus of the institute, spread across 32 acres of land, will take a big step towards becoming a clean energy campus with the introduction of the solar project.
A delightful lecture we have heard today. A peep into the future banking. How nicely it has been narrated by an expert in banking, Madam Arundhati Battacharya. We enjoyed this. In fact, she gave a clear picture as to what is in. In fact, I am overwhelmed with joy that we, the audience, enjoyed it fully. And you know, everybody wants to know what is in future for the banking. You told that it is multidisciplinary.
Yes,
it is multidisciplinary now, that bankers do all the jobs. Finally, we say we also do banking. That is the importance now, because banking has taken the back steps and all other activities have come in the forefront, and now we also do banking. And she has narrated the importance of technology, how technology is playing a major role in banking. Yes, the technology investment for banks has risen tremendously, I should say. And the right technology we have to use at right place, that is what she has warned. And if at all we are spending for technology, we should not spend the amount for wrong things or wrong selection of the hardwares, whatever may it be. The right choice should be there so that our investment will be optimum to use the best for the banking. And she warned us on cyber threat. Yes, all the bankers are now worried about cyber threat. And she told that we should be one step ahead of what the people are in the cyber threat area. That means we should have experts in the field of technology, and we should employ those experts and spend more for that to fight for this cyber threat. Yes, we are also doing it, madam. We are aware of it, the cyber threat which we are facing. And right kind of applications to get the right kind of results. A very important statement she has made. A right kind of applications to get the right kind of results. This is very important. My IT colleagues will pause and once again read this sentence and work on that, because when they select the applications, they should be very, very careful so that we spend the right amount for the right application to get the right results. And she has clearly narrated what is digital banking. She told mobile banking is not a digital banking, or internet banking is not a digital banking. Digital banking is something else, and that is exactly what we are doing in our KBL Vikas, that what a very, very dear thing what our present MD has taken up in the last 2 years, and we went for digital banking, exactly the digital banking. We opened a Digi Bank in the footsteps what we have learned from State Bank of India. In fact, when State Bank of India opened Digi Branch, in fact in Mangalore also, in Vijay we have a digital bank, Digi Branch, and I also visited at that time because I was also curious to know what is Digi Banking. And it was opened in Mangalore also, and as you said, everything is there. It is 24/7, and this Digi Banking we also opened in our Basangudi, and it is working very well. And all other digital activities we have started, and we are into tab banking now, like opening of SBI accounts in the tabs, opening up loan accounts in the tabs. All these things we have already started, and you have given us the right direction, and we have already peeped into the future bank. That's what I can say. Friends, I will not deal much with what Mrs. Battacharya has told, because she has to leave now to the airport. I will summarize that this speech what Madam Battacharya gave us was a clear insight into our future banking, and we in the private sector, we are eager to catch up those banking activities and to stand in the forefront of the banking sector and give the best service to our loyal customers. We have all loyal customers here, and we assure you on behalf of MD that we will give the best of best service by using this technology. In fact, we started core banking in 2000 when our past chairman MS Krishna Bhat and Anand Krishna were there. They thought that is the future banking, and we introduced this core banking somewhere in 2000 when no other bankers have started, and we reaped the benefits out of that. And now we have entered into the third phase of this digital banking, and we are into it and reaping the benefits now. Friends, am glad that our bank is growing fast, and we have about 1,26,000 crores of turnover, and we have almost reached a good profit, net profit last year. Bank's health is measured by its return on assets, capital adequacy level, and return on equity. These are the three parameters: return on assets, capital adequacy level, and return on equity. For private sector banks, capital raising is a challenging exercise. You know, we have to canvas capital from the public, not like the nationalized banks where government is giving the capital. The investors have also become very choosy. Investors means those who invest in capital, they have become very choosy, calculative, and more intelligent. Preservation of capital without allowing it to get diluted on account of increase in non-interest earning, non-performing assets is a responsibility of the management and especially of the staff members. I am repeating it because we have to preserve the capital. That means you should not increase the NPAs so that we increase the non-interest bearing assets, and this is the responsibility of each one of us in the bank. Nowadays, depositors are also selective and do not blindly invest in bank deposits simply because interest rate of that particular bank is high compared to others. If one particular bank is paying more interest on deposits, the depositors are not blindly going to that bank and investing, because they are also very intelligent now and they will choose the bankers. They look at the stability of the bank and ultimately the safety of their deposits. The Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation of India has recently increased the safety net to rupees 5 lakhs to build the confidence level of depositors, which is a very welcome move. Our bank has just taken up the exercise of raising its equity to have a healthy buffer level over the regulatory requirements. RBI is our regulator, and that has prescribed some minimum level of capital holding, and we always hold a slightly higher amount than what is required. That is called the buffer amount, and hence bank has come out with the proposal of QAP and has sought the nod of shareholders. We have sent letters to all the shareholders. As a chairman of the bank, I seek the full support of the shareholders for this, because that resolution has to be passed. We have already sent a letter to all the shareholders. Meanwhile, as the MD has put it, as a goodwill gesture, bank has also proposed to reward with a bonus gift to our shareholders. I think since after a very long time we are giving this bonus gift by issuing one share to every 10 shares held by them, and by your continuous support, I am hopeful that bank will become further strong to serve you better and bring a win-win situation for all the stakeholders. So friends, continue to support us, continue to support Karnataka Bank. Bank is growing year after year under the able leadership of the present MD, Mr. Mahabaleshwara, and let it grow and celebrate this centenary year with all vigor and strength. Friends, on this occasion, we salute our founders and invoke their continued blessings to rededicate ourselves to achieve more, to create value for all concerned. We are grateful to our valued customers, shareholders, investors for their continued support and patronage. We are also grateful to our well-wishers, friends, and public who always value us with good respect and faith. Thank you very much.
It is said that gratitude is the healthiest of all emotions. The word thank you is the most graceful form of courtesy, and it is the best prayer anyone could say. On this momentous occasion of 96 years of purposeful existence, I deem it a great honor and privilege to propose a vote of thanks. Firstly,
I would like to bow my head in deep reverence and gratitude to the founding fathers of this great organization, to whom we are ever indebted for this priceless treasure called Karnataka Bank. I express my profound gratitude to Srimati Arundhati Battacharya for her gracious presence and for delivering Founders Day lecture. Madam, Karnataka Bank is honored to have you with us on this very special occasion. We thank you, madam, for leaving an imprint on our minds with your thought-provoking speech. Today's Founders Day lecture will remain green in our minds for many more years to come. Thank you for accepting our invitation and sparing your invaluable time to be with us today. Thank you, ma'am. My heartfelt thanks to our esteemed chairman, Sri P.Jayarama Bhat, for presiding over today's function. As you all know, Sri P.Jayarama Bhat had effortlessly steered this bank as MD&CEO for more than 8 years, and the bank had witnessed several highs during that period. Presently, as the chairman, he is a guiding force and great source of strength for all of us. Thank you, sir, for presiding over today's function. Thank you. Our beloved managing director and CEO, Sri Mahabaleshwara MS, who has taken over the reins of this bank in the year 2017, is a visionary who has a great dream for Karnataka Bank. He has been taking dynamic and rapid strides, making a mark in the banking industry. He is a person with innovative and creative ideas, always waiting to put them into action. Under his leadership, our bank undertook a bold transformation journey named KBL Vikas to reposition itself as a big, strong and vibrant bank coupled with socially responsible values. Thank you, sir, for your guidance and gracious presence.